السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، Welcome to our second session of Ramadan Fiqh Bits according to the school of Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. So last time we were here, we started with some of the introductions about Ramadan. We talked about the virtue of Ramadan, and then we talked about the definition of Ramadan, and then we started talking about the different aspects, how we're going to cover this session based on that definition. And so alhamdulillah, we were able to cover the intention, which is the first aspect of that definition, because remember when we said Ramadan, what does Ramadan, fasting Ramadan mean? It's intention withholding from specific things, at a specific time, from a specific person. And so inshallah, these are the four categories we're gonna discuss. But I have to add, inshallah, at the end of this, if we have a few more sessions, we might add the i'tikaf, and maybe even the zakat al-fitr, because this is obviously associated with Ramadan. So today, inshallah, I'm hoping that we would cover the time aspect. And when we talk about specific time over here, we will cover things such as which part of the day we were going to fast, but also how do we determine the beginning and the middle of the month, and the conditions of the individuals who are considered required, or the conditions that are required in those individuals to witness the start and the beginning of the month. And inshallah, if we have time, we're going to talk about the specific individuals who are it's obligated upon for them to fast. And then we might defer to the following session, inshallah, those who are excused from fasting. All right, so let's dive into this. When we talk about time over here, we all know that which part of the day we need to fast. We are fasting from Fajr all the way to Maghrib, as mentioned in the verse of the Quran. Now, when we say Fajr over here, we're not talking about sunrise. Because quite often, sometimes this is a mistake when we try to explain to some of the non-Muslims, when do we have to fast, what periods, and we try to encourage them to come with us and participate. We tell them we have to fast from sunrise to sunset, but that's not true. That is incorrect. They have missed part of the fasting because they're supposed to fast from Fajr, not sunrise. Sunrise is Shuruq. They have to fast prior to that, which is Fajr, which is the true Fajr, which the first light of the sun, when it starts coming out, it comes out from the horizon. So the beam of light goes out the horizon and then it rises. Once that beam comes out through the horizon, this is when we're supposed to start our fast. And so it is from Fajr all the way to sunset. In this section, we're going to be talking about, well, how do we determine when Ramadan starts and when it ends? The only legitimate way to determine this in the Hanbali school of thought is by moon sighting. So you go out there and you try to sight the moon, you see the crescent. This is the only legitimate way that is considered for us to enter Ramadan. Now, obviously, you could see the crescent or you're not, but the point is you're trying to see it. We're going to talk about these details in inshallah the next slide or so. So this is talking about how we determine the beginning of the month. It is by moon sighting, but also how we exit the month. It is by moon sighting. When we're talking about moon sighting over here, we are referring to the global moon sighting, because in the Hanbali school of thought, in fact, the majority of the scholars, they adopt the opinion that it's global moon sighting, because the Prophet ﷺ said, "Sumu lirru'yati wa aftiru lirru'yati," which means fast when you see it and break your fast when you see it. So you start Ramadan when you see the moon, and you stop Ramadan when you see the moon. And the only way we can fulfill this as an ummah is if we all do it at the same time. And the only way this is possible is if we adopt the global moon sighting opinion. All right, now when we talk about how many people are required to sight the moon, Ramadan is special among all the months. The Prophet ﷺ, in his practice when he did this, he showed that exception. And the reason behind it is because you want to make sure that you don't miss anything from that obligation. And so you go on the cautious side a bit more. And in this particular month, we accept the confirmation of the start of the month by one trustworthy adult seeing the crescent. That's all it requires. It requires only one trustworthy adult, whether male or female, to sight the moon. And so then all the entire ummah fasts based on that. And this was the practice of the Prophet ﷺ. All other months, on the other hand, including the exit of Ramadan, so the end of Ramadan, how would you determine this? By the start of Shawwal. And so the Shawwal, for us to determine that it has entered, the moon has to be sighted by two trustworthy adult males, similar to all the other months, whether it's Rajab, whether it's Sha'ban, all the other months. The only exception is Ramadan. It only requires one individual. All right, now that being said, we are out there. We have, like, you know, left, went out in the 30th night of Sha'ban. We're out there, we're excited, we're gonna wanna see the moon. And the reason I said the 30th night of Sha'ban is because in Islam, the night supersedes the day. So in this particular situation, the 29th day of Sha'ban has ended, and the next day is the 30th day of the Sha'ban, possibly, but it is now the 30th night. We're out there, we're trying to sight the moon, and there are two possibilities that can happen. One, either it's a clear night, it's clear sky, or it's a non-clear sky, because sighting requires it to be happening after Maghrib. Not prior to Maghrib, you can't sight the moon during the day. That doesn't count. It has to be after Maghrib. So now these are the two scenarios, these are possibilities. Clear night or clear sky, or not a clear sky. And not a clear sky over here, I put an example of cloudy, but all those situations can include, for example, a sandstorm or a blizzard, a snowstorm that prevents us from seeing the moon. Now, if it's a clear night or a clear sky, there are two possibilities that can happen. We can either sight the moon or we do not see the moon. Obviously, if we see the crescent, then the first day of Ramadan is the next day, and that's the day one of Ramadan. And in that night, we pray Taraweeh, we have our suhoor, we do all these things. Now, if you do not see the crescent, then what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to continue the month of Sha'ban 30 days, and we do not consider it the first day of Ramadan. And it's disliked fast that day in the Hanbali school of thought, because this is what's considered the day of doubt, the Yom al-Shak. When it's a clear night and you don't see the moon, you do not fast that 30th day. The only exception is if it's a regular fast that you usually fast by habit. For example, if you usually fast on a Monday, and this day happens to fall on a Monday, that 30th day of Sha'ban, of the clear sky, if it happens to fall on a Monday, then it's okay for you to fast. Otherwise, it is disliked. Now, these two scenarios is agreed upon among all the scholars. It's unanimously agreed upon. These two scenarios, this is how we determine the month of Ramadan. The one scenario that is different, or there's difference between among the scholars, is what do we do when it is a cloudy night and we're unable to see the crescent? Well, in the Hanbali school of thought, it means because you want to be cautious, an error on the caution side, we will consider it the first day of Ramadan the next day. And this was the habit of, or it's reported from, about 8 of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, such as Umar ibn Khattab, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhum, Aisha radiallahu anha, Asma bint Abi Bakr, and 4 other in Sahaba that have been reported that this was their habit. If it's a cloudy night, they would wake up the next morning fasting at Ramadan because they would say that I rather fast an extra day as opposed to miss a day of fasting in Ramadan. And so we caution a little bit more and we fast that day. We're considered as a mandatory fast. It's mandatory for, in this case then, to fast that day of Ramadan. So just so we can be careful. But once again, this last scenario, there's a difference of opinion between scholars. This is a particular to the Hanbali school of thought. All right, now that being said, tomorrow is Ramadan. Who is it obligatory upon to fast? It is obligated upon the Muslim, adult, sane, able person to fast Ramadan. Now, these categories are important. The reason we say it's Muslim is because the non-Muslim, for example, if they had become a Muslim in the middle of Ramadan, do they have to make up the days they missed or not? Well, the answer is no, because they were not Muslim at the beginning of Ramadan. They became Muslim in the middle of Ramadan, so they only have to, they're obligated to fast the remainder of it. But this is also something that Islam does to encourage the non-Muslims to become Muslims, because otherwise it means that if they had become Muslim, they have to make up all the missed Ramadans before that. And this is not the practice of the Prophet ﷺ. And so this is why we say it is a condition for the obligation that this individual be a Muslim, that they have to fast Ramadan, which means if they don't fast that day, it's a sin. Sanity obviously is a prerequisite because you're only liable based on your sanity. Adult, that's understandable, but what about if you're children? Now, of course, when we talk about an adult over here, we're talking about an individual who has reached the age of puberty. But what about children? Do they have to fast? The answer is no. And if they fast, it is a voluntary fast for them, right? They're rewarded for it, alhamdulillah. Their sins are not written, but the rewards are written. But that being said, it is mandatory for the parents to order the discerning, able child who can fast to fast. This is the Hanbali opinion. It is obligatory upon the parents, similar to how it's obligatory upon the parents to teach a discerning child to pray. Because it's our responsibility to teach them this religion, to teach them this practice, and also to train them so that by the time they become adults, by the time they reach the age of puberty, it's easy for them. They are trained to do it. It becomes a habit for them, so it's not difficult anymore. You can ask any individual, the non-Muslims, for example, what is the hardest thing that they experience? They say that first Ramadan was the toughest for them because they're not used to it. In this case, this is why it's important for us to train our children when they're young. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to try to distract their children by toys so that they would distract them from the hunger, distract them from the food. So similarly, we need to train our children to fast at the age, starting at the year 7. So this is the discerning age. And obviously, and then when we talk about the age 7, we're talking about the lunar calendar over here. We're not talking about the solar calendar. So they're 7 years old based on the lunar calendar. So it's always recommended for us to know which month of the Islamic calendar the children were born and which day. I did skip sanity because it's going to take a bit longer, so I'm going to go to it right now. I put several situations over here under this. In the books of fiqh and Hanbali school, you might see a couple of them in the aspect when we talk about intention. So over here, when we talk about sanity, I put in there, what about momentary insanity, individuals who go into a state of comatose, or a person who sleeps the entire day. What about their fasting? Is it counted or is not counted? And so over here, provided the situation, the prerequisite, the condition, is that all these individuals, they had made the intention the night prior to that, that would be fasting. So they, whether they got up for suhoor or when they went to sleep after Isha, they said, I'm fasting the next day. They made that intention and they went to sleep. And so in one scenario, this individual, may Allah protect all of us, went into a state of momentary insanity. So they can maintain this momentary insanity the entire day from Fajr to Maghrib, or they might wake up and become sane in the middle of the day. In the case where they go through that momentary insanity the entire day from Fajr to night, well, their fast obviously doesn't count. Because one, they're not liable, and two, they have no intention. Their intention doesn't count. Because remember, when we fast, we have to intentionally withhold and refrain from specific things. So intention over here is important, and a person who is insane has no intention. Well, what if they wake up in the middle of the day? They become insane in the middle of the day, whether it's Dhuhr or Asr, just any time before Maghrib, even if it's 10 minutes before Maghrib, then their fast counts because they are able to, with intention, withhold from the specific things they need to withhold from. Do they have to make up the day that they were momentarily insane in for the entire day? Well, the answer is no, because they're not liable. What about individuals who are in a state of comatose, which means that they are in deep sleep, they're not responding to external stimulus, no matter how much you shake them, they're just not waking up. It's a state of a coma, I guess. Well, the same thing we're going to look at it, is it for the full day or not, from Fajr to Maghrib, or is it part of the day? Obviously, if it's part of the day, then similarly, these individuals, their fasting counts, because they are able to withhold with intention, withhold from specific things. Well, what if they go into a coma the entire day from Fajr to Maghrib? Well, then their fast does not count because there is no intention aspect involved in it. And this is what was reported by one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that he had went to a coma for a couple of days. He made up those days, which means, yes, those days that a person who goes into a coma, they have to make up those days later on. This is different than a person who goes into insanity because they're not liable. But a person in a coma, they're still considered liable. The last scenario is, what about an individual who sleeps the entire day? They wake up for suhoor. There's an hour and half an hour still before Maghrib, before Fajr, and they went to sleep. Or they slept from Isha after Isha all the way until the next day, Maghrib. Quite a beautiful, intense, very deep sleep. Now, we're not going to be discussing, they missed, the Fajr and the Maghrib and missed, the prayers. Is this valid? Is not valid? We're going to ignore all that. We're just specifically looking at the validity of their fast. Is it valid or not? The answer is yes, it is valid. Because these individuals, if you wake them up, they will respond to the stimulus. That's just a quick recap about these things. And inshallah, we're going to stop at the able condition, because this is a gateway for those who are excused. from fasting. We'll see you inshallah next session. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.